大家好，欢迎收看建筑家，我是 April，
我是小宝。小宝啊，平常你有在做环保吗？
有，我平常都有收集那些瓶瓶罐罐之外啊，还有使用一些节能的电器。哇，算是做得很不错喽。但是在房屋方面呢，除了使用节能的电器之外，还有其他的方法可以环保哦。
不如我们先来看下吧。
温哥华这个城市是这么漂亮，在世界排名每年都是数一数二的最适宜居住的城市。那我们可以有这个机会来参与这个城市的造景。这个部分讲严肃一点是，你有你的使命在。我们希望说，我们替城市创造的是正面的风貌。
I'm an architect who works in Asia and in the U.S. and over in different parts of the world, Australia and in Europe. I'm also a biologist. My undergraduate degree was in biology. So I really do appreciate when people talk about creating a better environment, because we're all talking about a common goal, and that's to create a better future for our children. As an architect, everyone's talking about this thing called LEED. LEED stands for Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design. It actually, you know, people don't know this. People think it came from the United States. It actually started in Vancouver, UBC, a bunch of people who came up with the idea.
就是说你要达到这个绿建筑的比例，有几个分数呢，它才让你申请土地变更，来让你申请从single house 变成 townhouse. 譬如说，它在这个电器用品上面，我们电器用品可以选择 Energy Star， 就是节能的电器用品。 那另外呢，在你的这个暖气系统上面，你可以用 heat pump， 也是高效能的这个暖气跟空调系统。那再来呢，它会细到说你的垃圾回收，我们垃圾工地的产生的一些工程的废弃物，你是木头的部分的，把木头集中在一起，不是木头的，你把它分类。我们工地也做到这种垃圾。
这个工地废弃物的分类，就像我们要节水来讲，这两年起码温哥华的法规已经改过了，所以说你温哥华的盖新房，你的马桶它一定要丢 flush， 就一定要两段式冲水。可是我们可以注意到，就是说我们可能20年前、30年前的房子，如果说我们是有那样子的家，你进去是通常还没有两段的。
基于环保的概念，大家认为说木头。 树我们应该尽量让它保持，不要砍那么多树，所以就相对的有出现所谓的这个甲板，或是 OSB 板，这些材料呢来代替实木的。 这个材料，我们可以就是说，在我们的insulation
这一方面，我们可以就是去加强保温棉用的好一点，然后让它就是说，在这个保温的过程，包括门四周围的门缝，我们去处理就 seal 的比较好，让它热气不外流，让能量保存在室内。譬如说，很简单的，我们在做
townhouse， 我们的屋顶有雨水。
我们雨水可以把它回收啊，回收再放到中庭里面的花园的用水，去浇花啊等等。像我自己目前来讲，就是说，如果说我环保这一方面我用最多的或者最好，我最有去响应的就是在灯的选择上。 因为我现在大量的使用 LED 灯，那这个也就是说，我们就是可以节能，就可以省电。对我来讲是在设计上给了我很大的弹性跟可以发挥。那另外一点来讲就是环保，因为它接下来我们耗电量很省了。
As an architect, I find that LEED is a very interesting way to document how a good practice of building a good building. Some of the issues that I've seen. That come up of recent is that there's a big jump towards LEED, and people talk about it without really understanding what it really means and what the implications are. It's a business, okay? Architecture is a business. The selling of real estate is a business. So everybody wants to have good marketing material. Because there's such a rush towards acquiring LEED certification, that there's lots of technology out there that will claim, make all sorts of claims that these things will work and give you a LEED. But a lot of stuff have not been tested. A lot of mechanical systems, for example, will say that we have a high efficiency, but we actually find out in a number of cases now that the efficiency really isn't there, or the maintenance of it is a complete different headache in itself. You can have this really nice technology, but the people who are running it, operating it from year to year, don't understand how to really properly maintain it. Some of the products out there, I would say I would be very nervous to use. There's talk about these compact fluorescent lights that give off dirty electricity, or even UV rays, UV thing that's bad for your health, and or they contain mercury. So what do you do with it afterwards? And myself as a biologist, I get really unhappy when some of the larger, more well-organized companies promote their products as being lean and environmentally friendly, whereas the stuff that really is friendly aren't allowed to be qualified as lead. For example, wood. We all know that wood is a natural product, but for a long time there, wood as a product was not a lead product. They didn't recognize it. Even though we know it's natural, it's healthy, and it captures carbon, because the industry, you know, it's all about business. And that's what really disturbs me about this whole marketing of these green things. So when I look at green design and green houses, I look at a healthy house. Because when you say green, people don't really understand what that means. They think you put some grass on top of the roof or grow some trees or ride a bicycle. But that's just a superficial aspect. I would like to suggest that to do a real healthy house, you start with a house that really gives you a healthy mindset. So to have a healthy mindset is a healthy family by having natural light. So encourage natural light into your house. They also encourage the house to breathe. So house is like a living organism. It also has to breathe. So how do you do that? So you have rooms, your bedrooms, for example, that have windows that open on opposite sides of the wall. So one wall over here that has a window open up, then you might have another wall on the opposite side that opens up. So at nighttime, when you're very hot, the air just goes through naturally. So naturally breeze. And what I do in a lot of my homes is I create a light well. So on the staircase, I will have a skylight on top of the staircase. That skylight can open up. If it opens up, not only does it allow the fresh air to circulate, because all the warm air will rise right up and exit your house. So these are little simple things. Let's even make it work faster, more efficient. So I would put windows towards a basement that you can open up at nighttime. Small little windows, very, very tiny windows that doesn't allow anyone to sneak in or to come into your house. Small little slots so that you can open that a little bit at nighttime, so the cool air from the basement will rise up to the stairwell, all the way up to the main floor, second floor, and out to the skylight. So your whole house breathes. So it's very, very simple air movement. In a house, we know that there's gonna be lights at nighttime that are switched on. And he said, well, you can put these energy-saving lights. I said, well, okay, well, that's a good start. But wouldn't it be easier? You have light switches all over the place. So you walk from one room into the other room. You can just open a light here on one side. By the time you walk across into the other room, you can turn it off on this side. So you make it easy for people to turn on and turn off lights. So these are things I call green, healthy design.
I want to do this because now the environmental awareness is rising. We always hope that one planet, we protect this planet. We try to do what we can do to be a part of this planet's citizens. 我们从我们切身每天做的事情可以开始做到的话，我觉得这是一个蛮好的一个事情。他有问题是关于这个最近的温哥华批准的一些
permit， 关于后巷屋Laneway Homes 的一些问题。他想说，到底适不适合我家呢？我可不可以盖呢？对啊，适合我家未必适合你家哦。不如我们来看一下。好的。
We've built here is actually a place for my daughter and I. It's two bedrooms, one and a half bathroom. Originally there was a garage here, but it only functioned as a garage, and now we've kind of made this space a little bit more accessible.
对，Laneway Home 在我们的看法来讲是比较好的一种形式。 那现在也很多人都申请嘛，09年到现在有100多户申请，那么得到批准了。Laneway
Home 其实是温哥华这两年一种新兴的产品，这是他想说让大家有多一点点的 生活空间，而去在低密度的地方、低密度的住宅区多一点，就是说居住的空间，而去产生一种产品。那这是他当初就是说一个 idea 的来源。
那 living home 有的是在这个 garage 上面呢，也可能在旁边，这都是不是很难的事情。living home 的建筑时间和建房的时间是不太一样的，因为 living home 还是小嘛。
And if you really want to see how good laneway homes can be designed, there are some really good ones. So the ones that are designed by some of these laneway home designers and some of the architects, well, I think were very, very clever because they know that you have a small footprint, so you have tall spaces. So the tall spaces can help accentuate some of the tight spaces and you really make it work well.
那 laneway home 其实它有好有坏。那你可以说好处是我们多增加了很多生活的空间，因为你可以有一房一厅一个厨房一个卫浴，对不对？基本就是大概一个小套房，一个小的 apartment， 就是大概一房的小 apartment 的这样一个形式，那是在后巷屋这样子出现。那它另外一个缺点就是说我们一般倒垃圾，对不对？我们一般倒垃圾这些都是在后巷嘛，所以说如果说你住在那边的话，可能就是说你到垃圾啦，然后就垃圾车来收垃圾的时候，通常就是每天都会经过你的窗前。
The good is creating some housing. It's wonderful that you're making use of some perhaps underutilized potential of land. But laneway houses are very expensive to build. Dollars per square foot is actually very, very expensive.
最主要是 laneway home 它一样要打地基。它好像就盖一个小小的 house 一样，它一样打地基，对不对？然后它一样要有 retaining wall， 一样要灌水泥，那一样这样去盖起来，它一样要有水，要有电。
And you need permits. The permits in itself for a laneway house is the same as getting one for a brand new house. And having worked with the city on it, I just found that the effort to push it through was quite an interesting and tedious effort. And myself, doing a laneway house. I find it easier to design an office building to do a laneway house to get it to the city in Vancouver. So that's just my own personal experience. It took almost a year and a half just to get the permit. And that permit cost will cost you a lot of money. Well, it's one of the factors people don't think about. The other things you have to think about is your sewer line. How do you connect your sewer line? Do you connect to your existing sewer? Well, you might have to redo your entire sewer line. You have to rip up all the sewer line. So that's an added cost.So when it comes to answer the question of whether you want to build a laneway house or not, the economics are a really big factor because it's, I personally don't feel it makes economic sense unless you build a brand new house. I would look at other reasons for doing it.
也是为了应对这个城市啊越来越拥挤，人口那个密度越来越高呢。
没错，小归小，不过还是可以很温馨的。麻雀虽小，五脏俱全，所以千万不要看到它小，所以就小看它了。嗯。
My family's been in Canada for over 150 years, and I'm very proud to be a creature of Chinese ancestry.Because of my heritage, I tried very, very much to incorporate a lot of the Chinese ideas and notions of spatial design. Big spaces are very anonymous and sometimes feel very empty. And it's, you know, psychologically sometimes not that good. In small spaces, the best thing about small spaces is the ability to be very close to natural daylight and natural airflow. And that in itself, if you look at energy savings,you don't need to heat up a big space and, you know, or cool down the space. In addition, smaller spaces also allow a closer ability to sit together as friends and family. And you know, the other thing is that the spaces might be small horizontally, but it can be higher. Because I feel that the height actually to me is more important than the width. Because you can have a very, very big room, but if your ceiling is very small, it feels very cramped.But even if you have a very small space, but it's very, very tall, it feels very spacious and very like uplifting. So these are the ideas in Chinese architecture is very, very strong. Chinese design, people don't understand that. They all think it's these nice, beautiful Chinese buildings, but it's more than that. It's a layering of space. how the spaces come together in hierarchy, and how the adjunct or smaller spaces come together, and how all comes together and form a much more beautiful space. So for example, you walk into a traditional Chinese courtyard home, and when you walk through the front door, it's usually centralized. And just before you walk in there, because of the ideas of feng shui, there might be a wall, a feng shui screen. So that in itself, you think about it, it makes your mind think, what's behind that wall? So when you walk in right away, you're greeted by this beautiful wall, and then you turn to the left or you turn to the right. And you turn to the left or right, all of a sudden you have a nice big courtyard space, a nice big open space. So then you're all of a sudden delightfully greeted with a big open space. To appreciate the very nice space that you have, you have to force yourself to think small and then look at a space and it feels bigger. Because the very simple action of walking through a very tight space and then walking through another space a little bit bigger, it makes your mind think that the next space is much bigger than the original space. Around that big square, you have all these rooms that face onto that open space. And you know that open space will serve more than just having natural air and natural daylight. It also serves as a focus for ordering and having all the spaces sort of be secondary to that big space. And that's how it really works, that the ordering of space is having a main feature, and you can do it in the house, so you can have a main feature, maybe a living room, and then you can take your smaller rooms, could be your dens, could be, you know, reading room, library, children's study area, playroom, and all to focus around the space. And that's how a very successful design can be applied. And that's what we can learn from Chinese design, is the ordering, organization, and taking advantage of your limitations to really make your space, we call it to sing, to be, you know, to be like poetry. And it can be done. A lot of beautiful buildings are done that way.
住的舒不舒服其实跟大小不一定有直接的关系呢。
没错，我们在下一集节目当中会告诉大家正式动工的时候要注意哪一些事项呢？不如我们下个礼拜同一个时间再见咯。
下礼拜见，拜拜。